Center, and I hear there are you have a pretty good audience today. So I hear there's some new beekeepers here. Is that true? Any new beekeepers in there? All right, excellent. Where's everyone coming from today? Anybody come from the coast? Yeah, coast. Anybody
this
come?
Is the Tillamook Bee Club.
Tillamook Bee Club.
Oh,
welcome. anybody come from the valley today? You make it over the. How was the summit?
Good.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Good. That's getting a little bit better as the days going on here. So welcome to the Tillamook Forest Center. I do want to introduce a little bit about the Tillamook State Forest here, and then we'll introduce Christine when we get ready with the bee program. So the first thing I want to point out to you, we do this for all of our programs, because we need to explain to folks that we are not the U.S. Forest Service. We are the Oregon Department of Forestry. So that's a common misconception that we have here. There are a few state forests within Oregon, but you're the largest one right now, up in the northwest corner of the state, the Tillamook State Forest. And I bet most folks here in Tillamook are probably familiar with the Tillamook Burn. The Tillamook Burn was a series of four forest fires that devastated this forest, engulfed a huge area back in the 40s and 50s. 30s and 40s. With that big fire, there was actually a large reforestation effort that was done after the fires, where people came up from all over the area. Some folks came up from Tillamook, some folks came up from the valley, school groups came up here to plant trees. We had CCC groups planting trees. Our forest inmate camp at South Fork was planting trees here as well. And so they are the ones who helped build this forest back up to what it is today. And now we have a nice sea of green, beautiful sea of green in the forest as well. And the Oregon Department of Forestry is managing this forest now. And we manage it for the balance of values. And that balance of values is the social value. There's lots of people who come up here to go bike riding, to go hiking, camping, riding off-highway vehicles. We also are managing our forest for the environment, for the animals and plants that live here, trying to keep waterways clean as well. And the last piece is economic. We're actually funded through timber sales as well. And two-thirds of the timber revenue goes back to the counties here for things like schools and other county programs. So we are managing our forest for a balance of those things. And that's just a quick little intro to the Tillamook State Forest here. Now, the really neat thing that I'm really excited for right now is with this Fresh Fruit Forestry presentation series, what we're trying to do is help give people kind of a look at a different side of the Oregon Department of Forestry that they don't often see. So we're trying, this is a presentation series, and Christine is the first one, so thanks for starting us off. She is our forest entomologist. I'll tell you more about Christine in just a moment, but back to Fresh Fruit Forestry, we're going to be inviting other forest scientists to be doing presentations up here throughout the rest of the spring and also into the fall. So we're going to have one once a month. They're going to be on Saturdays. So keep an eye on our website for some of the other ones that are coming up. I know we're going to be talking about biomass and fungi, and in the fall we have some other really interesting ones that will be coming out soon. So you'll be seeing a little bit of that later. Now, I just want to tell you a little bit about Christine. She is our forest entomologist here for the Oregon Department of Forestry. She got her BS from Oregon State University and PhD from Wisconsin, University of Wisconsin. So she's done really a lot of projects all over the country, all over the state, and I'm going to need to actually remember where some of the places that you've gone, because you've done projects, entomology projects, ranging from public health to tropical forest ecosystems, and in Oregon, and also as far away as the country of Lebanon as well. So a lot of experience, and she goes all over the state teaching people about how to manage their forests for the insects that are here. And so we're super excited today because she's going to be talking all about native bees. So without further ado, I will turn it right over to Christine. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me here and showing up today. I know the weather's been a little interesting the past couple of weeks, but This is a relatively new venture that we're really excited about in forestry because bees are talked about in agriculture and urban areas a lot, even in tropical forestry where a lot of the trees happen to be pollinated. But in temperate forests, it really is understudied because a lot of our trees don't require pollination. That's not to say bees don't visit some of these trees, even conifers, but it's really underrepresented because we just don't see them playing a large role in the ecosystem in forests, but that's because we haven't looked at it. And the forests are actually a great reservoir for habitat for bees that is also understudied. So some of you, this might be information you already know, but we'll get started with the basics just in case you don't. I've already forgotten how you told me to advance this.
Yeah, you can take that around.
Just keep that. Okay, I will try that. maybe not too far. So this is going to be a really loose format. If you have questions, jump in at any time, comments. This is not going to be a whole hour worth of me talking at you, because I really want to encourage some engagement here and hear about what you might know. So just a little bit of background in case you don't know a lot about bees. Everybody knows the European honeybee, right? Honeybees. They're from Europe. They're actually not native. We do not have native honeybees here. But we bring them over, we keep them in hives, so basically we can make them our workforce for pollinating a lot of our agricultural crops, which are also European in origin, that are used to being pollinated by honeybees just due to a co-evolution between the two. But we also have a lot of native bees that are really important for pollinating some of our other crops, especially things like in the pea family, that these honeybees just can't really access because there's a snap mechanism to the flower that's really hard for them to bypass. But bees might wiggle their way in with vibration. Sometimes they're just heavier, like bumblebees, and they can just kind of sit on it, open it right up. But basically, different bees pollinate different flowers based on their biology and based on the shape of the flower, and I'll get a little bit more into that. But we have a wealth of native bees here that are really important, and they're living and nesting in areas that we don't typically think about, and we'll get into that. But a little bit of background. So the honeybees, historically, they were cavity nesters. They nested in things like trees, and there's a lot of evidence that there's a symbiosis between bees nesting in trees and some of the natural microorganisms in trees that would actually foster the health of that community. But the way that we're doing it now in hives, sometimes that's a really compressed environment for them. They're really crowded and disease thrives in that kind of environment, so that's been an issue. But basically we're kind of factory farming our bees right now, but historically they lived out dispersed in things like tree cavities. And so some of our wild bees are still living in that way, and I'll get into that. But most of our bees are social, or they can be solitary. So what that means is a honeybee is social. There's this community that's made up of different castes, and so each bee has a different job. They do something different for each other. They each serve a purpose, but they all are working together in the community. Solitary bees, they're on their own, just as it sounds like. They don't have a hive or a nest they really need to defend, so usually they're pretty passive. They can sting, but they're very passive because it's not this kind of mob mentality of protect the nest. Basically, what they'll do is, as you can see in this diagram, these different life cycles. This is the honeybee. This is bumblebee, which is also one of our very few social bees that we have here that is native. But a lot of our bees are solitary. And a lot of you are pretty familiar with some of these bees that you buy little tubes, you put them in your yard. Those are solitary bees. And what they're doing is each one of these is a cell here. And this is actually showing a different development. This is an egg, transforms into a larva, pupa, and then this is the late stage pupa that's emerging as an adult. So what they'll do is they'll just put an egg in some sort of cavity. It could be a pithy stem or anything that's a hole, and then they'll pack it with some nutrients for this insect to eat once it hatches out. They seal off that cell, they do it all over again. They'll make a bunch of sequential cells, and then they leave. Their job is done. They don't have to take care of that nest any longer. So that's a solitary bee life cycle. And most of our bees are solitary and ground nesting. Like I mentioned, we do have bumblebees, which are social. There are a couple of other social groups, but typically they are solitary. When you see a lot of them in one space, that's just really good habitat. They're living communally, but not working communally. So they just see a spot that they like. It's basically like an apartment complex. Doesn't mean this is a family. Doesn't mean they're buddies. It just means they're living close to each other.
But the bumblebees are different?
The bumblebees are different. Those are definitely social, like a honeybee.
Okay.
Yeah. So they actually have a nest and they will protect it, although they're still a bit more gentle than even honeybees. So I just wanted to show you the diversity of bees. And luckily, at Oregon Department of Agriculture, they have this great photo montage system, which basically means they just take picture after picture as the camera goes down to lower towards the bee so that all parts of the bee is in focus. That's really hard to do because it's really small, so oftentimes things in the background are a little fuzzy, but as you can see here, these are really nice clear images. You can find a bunch of them on their Flickr website. They make a poster. I have a small version of it on that table, but it's a poster that you can buy with a poster package of other bee poster or other insect posters. It's like $6, but it's really beautifully done. But it just goes to show you what wide diversity we have in our native bees. And these are all, they were all collected by the Oregon Department of Agriculture in Oregon, and then they made them pretty and took pictures of them. So, but yeah, just a wide, wide diversity. And I always like these weird ones that have like the huge antennae. They really stand out. So Oregon is a great place for bees in all different types of ecosystems, including agricultural setting. Mainly because we have such a diversity of species that we grow in terms of plants. So when you compare, and I'll show you a map of a comparison of the diversity of bees across the country, but when you compare crops that are grown in different states, Oregon is kind of a standout in terms of our agricultural diversity. We have a lot of specialty crops, a lot of berries, things like that. And all of these different types of plants provide a more diverse feeding habitat. So these bees have more things to forage from, and it encourages different types of bees based on these different types of flowers that are being produced from these plants. So we're really lucky in that we have high species diversity in our agricultural setting for our plants, and we don't have monoculture, large monoculture, as you see in the other parts of the country, in terms of growing just one plant throughout a huge landscape of the area. So for example, looking at the diversity amongst agricultural areas, our nation's breadbasket, as it's called in the Midwest, has a lot of different agricultural things going on, but there's also a lot of monoculture. And a lot of this monoculture is things like corn, which are not bee pollinated, that's wind pollinated. But they'll just have acres and acres and acres of one crop. So it doesn't really promote diversity because it's basically a landscape in which there isn't a lot of food for those bees, or it's just one type of food. But because we have the diversity of our specialty crops, you can see by comparison, and what this map is showing you is that in the green, that's a low diversity of bumblebees, and that's to be expected in things like a lot of parts of Texas just don't have plants that are flowering that the bees would be interested in. But if you compare between the agricultural areas, the high diversity, the red and the orange, is really high out in the west, and a lot of that is just because the speciosity of the crops that we have is just really diverse. So the bumblebee species we have in the Willamette Valley are some of the most diverse in the nation. And on top of that, we also have, so as I mentioned, honeybees we use for our purposes. We manage them, we want them to pollinate this area, or to bring us honey, we're gonna plant them in this area. We can also do that with some of our wild bees, and this is a very rare instance. But this is alkali bee, and basically what this is in Northeast Oregon, where we have alfalfa that's being pollinated by this bee. And what we did was, instead of having them in a hive, for example, because they're solitary, you can't do that, we just created habitat that they would like, and then if you build it, they will come. And that habitat, it's just a bunch of dirt. All they want is exposed soil. So you expose that soil, keep it exposed. There could be water sources nearby, because they do get thirsty. And that's all you need to do. And so then these bees just set up shop and they pollinate the alfalfa in the perimeter.
Is that water, those tanks?
Yeah, that could be irrigation for the alfalfa. This is a agricultural when I say we, I mean Oregon. Oregon Department of Forestry doesn't do that. So I'm not sure what the tanks are from, but probably for irrigation. But the bees will access any water. They, you know, puddles of water, they'll drink from that, and that's very important when we talk about pesticides a little bit later. But yeah, it's a very simple system to promote these bees, and it's very rare. As you see, it's the world's only managed ground nesting bee, and it's only being managed in a few parts of the world, and Oregon is one of them.
Are they healthier for that then, being ground nesting?
Are they healthier
than
the
in
a hive? Mm-hmm. That's a touchy subject because then it's like, well, if you have honeybees, you know, that's not healthy. When you can have a very healthy hive, but in general, yes, because it is a stressed environment when you have them in a hive all right next to each other. So when they're solitary, there's less risk of exposure, but they still have diseases, they still have mites that can still be transferred, just a little bit harder. So as I'm getting into, forestry is really important and underlooked, but also luckily in Oregon, we have some researchers at OSU that got interested in the subject. They kind of ventured into it, not knowing what they would find. They started finding that there were a lot of bees, especially in heavily managed systems. So where you see clear cuts, there were a lot of bees. And I'm talking about bees, not wasps in forestry, especially when I talk to people harvesting timber, they go, oh, I hate bees, because they're thinking about the ground nesting yellow jackets. I'm talking about the ground nesting native bees. So what these researchers found, some really interesting data in which when you provide this clear space, such as after a clear cut and then you burn some of the slash, you have exposed soil, at least temporarily until it's replanted, that the bees really like, and they'll utilize that for a few years until it's grown over. There's also an influx of light, and so there are a lot of plants that are coming up that are flowering. A lot of those do get sprayed to promote growth of the trees that we're planting so that they don't crowd them out, but those are really important for these bees that a lot are just transient. And so that's really important habitat for them until those trees grow up and close the canopy. And then you don't have a lot of the understory plants, but you still have some patches of exposed ground. So it's still a great site for nesting in the ground. And this is after fires as well. So not just in management of forests, but following fire, you'll see an increase in bee abundance and diversity. So a lot of different species and a lot in terms of population numbers. So, as I mentioned, forage plants are really important. There are a lot of plants in our forest, in the understory and along the sides of the forest that the bees can utilize. And then the bare soil for ground nests and for hibernation. Most of these bees, only the queen survives into the winter. So in a honeybee hive, you can just keep them thriving, right? But typically with our wild bees, and I'm gonna talk more so about wild bees than honeybees today, but in our wild bee systems, those females will, they're fertilized, and so they will live, the rest of the hive dies, and they hibernate. And then in spring, right now, they're starting to wake up. They'll go look for a spot that's great to start a new nest if they're a bumblebee or if they're solitary. They just look for an area that's good to, like a pithy stem. They want to start laying an egg and collecting pollen and nectar and making like bee loaves, just food, or they pack those two things together that they can feed to the young. And they will start their first individuals of the population. And then that's what the new colony for this year starts from that single female. There are a few that the male and female will survive, or that the young will survive, like in those stems. They wake up, they mate, they set the next population. But typically it's one lone female that starts the population over every year. Also what's important for their habitat is woody debris and stumps for their nests. So bees don't like to dig into the soil. They won't dig past debris. They like it exposed. They also won't dig into woody materials. They like holes that are pre-existing.
They like mole holes.
There's some of that too. Bumblebees absolutely love like mole, vole, rats, anything that burrows underground. They utilize those nests. They don't want to do too much work in their own. They got a lot of work ahead of them. So the forage plants, and this varies across the state. I kept this kind of western focus, but on the east side, there's a wide diversity of forest plants that they feed on. But all the ones that we're familiar with, rhododendron, salal, Oregon grape, currant, salmonberry, madrone, ceanothus, they love all these plants. You may have heard that they tend to like the yellow, the white, the blue, the purple flowers. Those are the spectrum of colors that they like. They will visit some others, but that's generally true. Flower shape is, however, most important. because it depends on the bee's tongue length and their body type. So when I mentioned about the pea plants, that bumblebees are really good at opening those plants because they have that snap mechanism, but their big body, they can just weigh it down and open it. Bee tongue lengths are really important. So if you have a shallow flower that doesn't have a long tube, bees with short tongues, and I have a couple examples in that case of a bee with a really tiny short tongue, that's what they will visit. Bees with a really long tongue, and they're ejected in some of those bumblebees, and you can see they're really long, you may not realize that's their tongue, they'll visit the flowers that have tubes just because they can access them. It's also been shown that bees will visit conifers. If you remember, conifers are wind pollinated, they do not require pollination, but that doesn't mean that they don't produce pollen bees are interested in, or sometimes they'll produce nectar sources that bees are interested in as well. Maple is a prime example. Early season maple, it blooms very early and the bees really like to utilize that nectar. So those trees are important. So if you look out here and you think that's not really bee habitat, it actually is. So the nests vary. They could just be little holes in the ground. They could be in stumps, any sort of crevices. Beetle exit holes are a favorite that they like to utilize those. Carpenter bees can do some chewing and make their own holes. They're one of the rarities. But oftentimes if there's a hole, they'll just use whatever they've got there. These are actually some nests. Remember I mentioned those cells that they make? Those are the cells to insert eggs into. And what I meant by pithy stems, I don't know if you noticed that, pithy stems, so anything like a caneberry, so even the terrible Himalayan blackberry that we do not like because it's invasive, has a nice thick stem and it has a pithy stem. So as long as those canes are dead, you snip them off, they're not resprouting, that's actually a great habitat. It's okay to leave it on the ground. If it's dried out, they really like that pithy stem because it's soft enough that they can dig into it and it's wide enough diameter they can nest in it. So I encourage you to think about the forest is great habitat, and also we have a lot of it in Oregon. It's very extensive, especially in the private sector. So a lot of small industry, some family woodlots, and also some larger industries take up big chunks of this. So if you can imagine, this is a huge landscape that we can really start to enhance habitat for bees and improve it even more. So we are attempting. So some of the ways that we're attempting that is we have these slash piles. So basically, once we do a cut, and they're not always clear cuts, sometimes it's patch cuts, sometimes it's selective, so I wouldn't always think of it in terms of a clear cut, but that is typically what we see on the west side because Doug fir responds very well to having a lot of sunlight. It's really hard to replant with Doug fir if they don't have full access to sunlight. But when we do these cuts, we get rid of the slash material. This is a lot of leftover material, branches, tops, things that aren't going to be taken on the truck. And so we'll burn those, and then you have this nice habitat that's like really nice exposed soil. And it looks terrible. It looks like scorched earth. We don't like it visually, but the bees love it. And they will nest in that. And also it's really easy to just throw in handfuls of annual seed or maybe even perennial to keep it going for a little bit longer until the trees that are being planted around these areas and within these burn spots are put in. It's hard to see here, but this is that same area, and it's got little trees, little Doug fir here and there that are coming up. So that habitat was utilized for nesting, and then some flowering plants are gonna come up. This is off season. And so the bees can utilize that until these trees grow up and then they close the canopy, and then the understory starts to die back again because it's really shaded and you have, again, exposed soil that's great for nesting. We're also trying to encourage planting along roadside. So for example, doing a bit of a cut along the roadside, removing some of those trees and instead planting flowers along that roadside edge. That's great forest habitat for bees. So yes, are we doing anything to enhance habitat? Absolutely we are. We're hitting it really hard. I have to say I'm pretty proud of my home state that we took this and ran with it in 2015. There were federal initiatives put forth for all pollinators, not just bees, but really heavily focused towards bees. And that same year in 2015, we had two state bills that came forward to give us money to do more work, and so we're putting that to work. And so a lot of people are participating. I know that I'm in every single one of these pictures, and that's because I took them. But I'm working hard too with a lot of these people. But Oregon State University has been essential, providing the research, providing the connectivity amongst groups to really try and push a lot of these efforts forward. ODF is a new partner in all of this, and we're very excited about it. A lot of different avenues that we're going in here. Oregon Department of Agriculture, again, just a really important agency involved in a lot of the agricultural side for bee habitat enhancement. And we also have some new joiners, and this is forestry specific. In forestry, we have Hampton Lumber, which on their own decided a couple years ago they wanted to enhance bee habitat on their stands, and so they started going with it. And they've been working with us to see how they can do it a little bit better, or us helping to disseminate what they're learning that's working and what's not working. So they're really providing the template and for other folks to follow. And so through word of mouth, Seneca Timber recently joined, and they're trying to enhance habitat in their stands similar to what's already happening. So a lot of people are putting this to work in very short order. And so I'm going to take a step back and give you all the background about bees in general and bees in forests. And now I'm going to generalize it even more. We've all heard about colony collapse. I told you about how bees are doing really well. I start with the good stuff, and I'm going to get into some of the sticky stuff. It's a little bit of a bummer that we have to tackle now. So bees are doing very well in Oregon, but we have had issues that the rest of the country has seen in the past as well, such as colony collapse disorder and honeybees, which we're all looking for. I get asked that all the time, why are the bees dying? It's not one answer. It's never going to be as simple as that. We would hope it would be, but it's not. It's loss of habitat for them to feed. It's pesticides that are affecting some of that habitat that they're bringing back into their hive. It's diseases, it's mites, it's a whole host of things that over time I think you just stress those systems heavily. And so that's really important because it's hurting a lot of economies. We need honeybees to pollinate, especially places like California, almonds, that's big business. So a lot of people are already looking at this, and actually at Oregon State University, they're analyzing this as well, looking at bee health over time. So this is being tackled. The native bees, that's a new thing. People are just now starting to go, well, what about the native bees? That's only one species of bee we're talking about with honeybees. What about all the natives? So we're noticing declines in them as well. There have also been some huge die-off events. So you may be familiar with some of the bumblebee kills that happened a few years ago in a Target parking lot. That got big news. They were spraying linden trees, which is a beautiful flowering tree used in street tree or parking lots. It's really pretty, it smells really good. Bees love it. It's one of the few trees that they actively visit. Bumblebees really love it. They spray those trees to kill the aphids because the aphids left the sticky residue in people's cars. We don't like that. It's an aesthetic issue. Not realizing that the pesticide that they sprayed actually travels to the nectar and it will harm these bees later on down the road. So these bumblebees visit it, and then you have large bee die-offs, and that's bad business, and ecologically it's pretty devastating. And so we really learn from these incidents and learn what did we do wrong and how can we fix that, and I'll tell you how we're doing that. So as I mentioned, 2015, we got some house bills to fund trying to enhance bee health and habitat. So that's anything from in the lab at OSU looking at, okay, what's killing some of these honeybees? Is this a new disease that they've come down with? Is this a new parasite? So, you know, kind of looking at those finer points and then trying to promote habitat enhancement. And so that money then went to places like the Oregon Bee Project. This is a group that is headed up by OSU, ODA, and now ODF, tasked with the above. So we're trying to enhance bee health and habitat and increase community engagement. So things like this, talking to people about bees, being aware of it. Just a little bit of community information goes a long way, but also larger scale projects where we're trying to help landowners enhance habitat on their sites, showing them how to do that, showing other folks, hey, look, aren't they doing a great job? Wouldn't you like to follow suit? This is how you do it. So just trying to bring all those groups together. Also, the Oregon Bee Project manages the Oregon Bee Atlas, which is a citizen science project, because we don't know what all bees we've got, what bees occur where. And so, I haven't shown you yet, but if you look at this way, you might have already seen it. But I got two winning prizes for people. How many bee species do you think we've identified in Oregon? And I'll give you a breakdown. Do you think it's like 10? Hands? 50? I only got two seed packets, so you can't all be right. 500? 1,000? Okay. So I saw back there two hands, so hand those back. It's 500. And that's only identified. We've got a lot more bees. So that's only what we know we've got. So we're actually trying to assess what else do we have out there. This is all we've known. We haven't really been looking. We probably got a lot more out there. And what abundance do they occur in? And where do they occur? So we haven't been sampling in forest habitats, for example. We don't know what all bees even occur in the forest habitat. So we're using citizen science to collect that information. And then, as I mentioned, OSU's been really great with doing a lot of research to fill in these knowledge gaps, especially in terms of bees that are occurring in forests. How are they occurring? How can we enhance them, enhance the habitat so they stick around or we bring more to the yard? And then we also have a research group that was born out of this, fostering collaborations, trying to say, hey, what are you working on? I'm doing something similar. Let's pair up. We can share information. We can share funds. And that's been really productive to try to get some of these questions answered. So how are we doing? So as I mentioned, some folks are already doing this work to enhance bee habitat, their property. This is golf course owners. This is agricultural growers, and now we've got some forestry folks, parks people. They're already doing this, and we want to showcase how well they're doing and things that aren't working so well so others can learn from it. That's equally important. So we're showcasing a lot of that. You might see the Oregon Bee Project emblem in some of these sites in which they've been certified. It's kind of like backyard bird habitat, but it's for bees, that they're really doing good things for bee habitat. Community engagement, that is one of our fearless leaders, Antonio Malafopoulos, that runs the Oregon Bee Project, and you see him in a variety of events. And then pesticide training, I'll talk a little bit more about pesticides. We're trying to talk to the folks that apply pesticides about, are you thinking about bees also when you're applying pesticides? And as I mentioned, the Bee Atlas for citizen science, diagnostics and research through Oregon State University to see what's going on with bee health. So what can you do, you specifically? You can enhance property on your habitat, and it's not as easy as just throwing out a handful of flower seed. Recently, Cheerios had flower seed packets, and it was aimed to protect bees and enhance their habitat, as their mascot is a honeybee. But that seed packet had a lot of invasive species in it. And those seeds aren't going to work across the nation. This isn't a cereal that's distributed just in one state. So this is problematic. So we want to get that information out there. What flowers are going to be best in your area? In forestry in particular, a lot of them are just look around what's growing there now. But then there's a list of things that maybe you might not be thinking about. We're trying to develop those lists regionally throughout the state. What's best in your part of the state? And then enhancing habitat in terms of ground space, providing some bare soil. It might look like something that's not good habitat to us, but it's actually great for them. Not sanitizing your site, you know, not picking up every little stick, every piece of debris, every cane from a blackberry stem, leaving some of that out because they like to nest in that material. That's really important. And then being really careful about pesticide application just as a landowner. This is something that, you know, we think, oh yeah, we know, we'll see the warnings. Well, they're not always clearly spelled out on the label. So I'll tell you a little bit about tips about things to think about when you're applying pesticides. Or join the Bee Atlas as a volunteer. We are always looking for more people. And it can be very simple. Sometimes they'll do like a day training, and it's really simple. You go in, you learn how to net a bee, collect the data, and that's it. You send it off to somebody else to identify. Or you can do a week-long training, learn to identify it yourself. Yeah.
If you discover it, you get an A.
Ooh. Probably. Yeah. Then there you go. I should have put that at the forefront. I think that would excite people more. And there's probably a high possibility we'll have some new finds with how little we've been looking. So, yeah, but citizen science, we're really trying to, we've got a lot of people, I'll get into that. We've got a lot of people that have already joined, and we're just trying to spread the word. So what are ways that you can enhance habitat? And this is in forestry specifically, or if you have, you know, even trees in your backyard, thinking about that type of habitat. So creating habitat, the flowers, the nesting sites, as I mentioned, especially in forgotten areas along roadsides, embankments. If you drive down a road and you see like the sandy soil embankment, if you look a little bit closer, you might see some holes in that embankment. Bees are already using it. So it might look ugly to us, but they actually like it. Along fence lines, that's a big one. Sometimes there's a narrow spot along a fence line and you don't think about what can I plant there. Throw a handful of seeds out. Concentrate on natives and looking at, well, I'll get to it, what types of, how you want to plant those seeds. It's not as easy as just throwing some seeds out. That was a little lazy of me to say that. Leave some sites with exposed soil. Remember, bees will not dig through debris. Even just your grass, some will dig a little bit, but they're not going to dig a lot. Leave or create some woody nesting materials, as I mentioned. Plant native flowering plants and shrubs. And trying to create a consistent or a constant flowering window is really important. So some flowers are short-term in terms of how often they're blooming or how long they're blooming. So planting a variety of species so that when that's had its blooming time that's finished, this next species will then take over. That's really important. Extending that blooming window or selecting species such as yarrow that has a long bloom window and will repeatedly bloom. New stalks will keep coming up through the season. Those are really great plants to focus on. Places like the Portland Nursery are really good about showing when a list of plants is blooming, and you can kind of pick and choose. Some are early, some are mid-season, some are late season, and try to formulate what plants you want in that way. Grouping plants with similar flower shapes, this is really important. So remember I mentioned that bee tongue length, and I mentioned a little bit, bees are a bit lazy because they've got other work to do. They don't want to seek out things that are far away. So what a bee will do, and you can see this in your yard, if you have one bush, for example, salvia, that's a great one. A lot of little flowers, and you'll see bees just go systematically, this flower to this one, to this one, to this one, to this one. They don't want to go, well, I've shopped here a little bit, I'm going to go to this other store and try that. No, they want to stick around that area. So if you can plant a clump of a similar shape of flower, color too, but that shape in terms of the depth of that flower, that's a strong signal. They'll come to that area and go, I like this patch, and they'll stick around. So that's really important rather than just a little bit here and a little bit there. Along that, creating a larger swath of plants is important versus, I think I'll just do a little patch of habitat here and a little bun here and a little bit here. There aren't corridors for them to travel. How will they know where that other patch is? Especially if they're small bees, they don't travel far. So if you can connect that habitat or instead just have one large swath instead of a bunch of little spots, that's actually preferable. But really, whatever you can do is going to be an enhancement. And then removing aggressive or invasive plants. So aggressive native plants or invasive plants that are really aggressive. Because even though there are plants like Scotch broom and Himalayan blackberry, the bees will still pollinate and they do get a lot of use out of it, they take over an area and reduce the overall plant diversity. And so there are other plants that aren't going to be coming up for other bees in that area. So removing those plants is really helpful.
Is there a place that we could get a list of plants?
So in forestry, no. And we're working on that. Basically, it's not as simple as going, yeah, bees will work statewide. Because, for example, in the Coast Range, Hampton Lumber has found that some of their species that were on these lists from the Xerces Society do not work in that area. They are hard to germinate. So we're working on that forestry. In any other setting, in your yard, urban and agricultural areas, there are tons of lists. You can just Google search it. You can go to the Oregon Bee Project website. They have a lot of those lists. The Xerces Society is also really good about putting those lists together. And the, I think it's USDA's NRCS program has several publications that are really good as well. And if you wanted to get all that information from me, I can give you my card after, and I can send you all of those. But we are using those lists to build on about what applies in forests. So that's a work in progress.
So are you part of the Atlas project too?
Me personally? A little bit.
Because that's where I got a huge foraging list, and it was really specific.
Yeah.
It was just to the West Coast, but not only that, it's specific to regions in Oregon.
Yeah.
So they have regions, they have a whole western coastal region.
Yeah.
We're trying to do that with the bee club too. We have a foraging team, and it'd be nice to,
yeah,
we're probably going to steal some of that info, but it's
totally,
also be nice to share back.
Yeah.
Learn some of that.
Yeah, absolutely. And we want to know that. So my role with the Atlas Project is I'm managing folks that are part of the Atlas Project. So just saying, here's an area, can you go and do your thing there? And the data that's really useful for us is when you folks go in and net a bee and tell me what plant it was actually visiting. Because we want to know that association. Just because we think this is a great flower for bees, it doesn't mean it's actually being visited. So that's what we want to build the list from. Also, some of the lists that the Atlas is pulling from are the Xerces list, and they're pulled from other lists that they're not proven. We don't know what germinates in each area. It's just based on the husbandry that we know about the plant, but it hasn't been tested. It seems like a simple thing, but as I mentioned, you know, Hampton has this list, and it's not working for them just because the coastal soil is a little bit different. So we really are trying to fine-tune those lists. They're great, a great place to start and just test for yourself what works and what doesn't. I would say don't heavily invest in, like, I'm going to buy all the seed stock from this list. Just try things out and see what works for you. You don't have to have 100 species of plants. We actually think it's better to focus on 5 to 10 species maybe, as long as you can have a long bloom window, because we don't want to overwhelm the bees, because sometimes it's just too much also.
The Tillamook Bee Association is really working on the foraging right now down there and trying to get.
Yeah.
And the one thing that I found fascinating is that two linden trees, that you said, she said she was interested, two linden trees equals an acre of blooming clover.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're heavily flowering trees. They're well visited. So, yeah. It's just, and those are, that's like the best bang for your buck species,
yeah,
you know? So, as I mentioned with, like, yarrow, like, if we can fine-tune what plants are really going to give us the best bang for our buck, it's great. Yeah. Oh, I didn't even cover this. I'm sorry. I'm skipping. Okay. Now we're going to move into the pesticide section. So, with pesticides, a lot of the labeling isn't consistent. It's well overdue. And you would think that all the labels would say one way or the other if there's high bee toxicity, but they're not all there yet. Sometimes the research is stuff that hasn't been done. But you know, a lot of times it has, and there's this great app. It's How to Reduce Bee Poisoning from Pesticides. This is an app that you can use on your phone. And it's a booklet too, so if you actually want to have a whole booklet, you can get that as well. But basically, all you do is you enter in the active ingredient, and it's hard to read, but I think this is acetate. And then it will tell you if it's high, medium, or low toxicity, and it'll give you a little bit more information. So it tells you right there, rather than having to scan the label yourself. So if you're thinking about using a product, I would look at that. So one thing I'd like to bring up, for example, is thinking about the example I mentioned with the aphids and the linden. Treating for one insect and not realizing the non-target effects. You really need to think about that. So, for example, who here has rhododendrons and azaleas? And have you started to see like that yellow mottling in some of those? Or they're not looking as green as they did. So we have a couple of insects, azalea lace bug, rhododendron lace bugs. But one of them is invasive that is hitting those plants. And it's this little insect that feeds on the underside, and it's sucking the chlorophyll out of the leaf. So the leaf turns yellow, it will not green back up. That's it. And so they look kind of bad. And so if you go to your typical garden store, big box store, and you say, hey, I have this issue, they'll say, here you go, here's imidacloprid, for example. Just pour that in the soil, it's a drench, and the plant will suck it right up, and, you know, problem solved. And it does work very well. But what it does is it's a systemic, and so even though it's short-lived in the duration in the soil, it breaks down, pulled up through that plant, it travels to nectar and pollen. What really likes to visit rhododendron and azaleas? Bees. So even months later, those bumblebees are going to start visiting those plants, and then they now have this product in their body, and they're taking it back to their young. So thinking about those things is really important, these non-target effects. But first, read the labels, follow the application rate, little bit more is not better. Usually the application rates listed are plenty. They've done a lot of testing. That's the rate that's going to be useful to kill whatever you're trying to kill. And then look for the obvious bee warnings on the label if you can find them, or just use this app. That'll pull them up. And then thinking about where you're applying pesticides is really important, and when you're applying pesticides. So applying, if at all possible, when bees are not active. So think about when they're not active, when it's really cold, at night, off season. But remember, some of these products have long residual times, and it could be months later that these bees will then start to visit these trees or plants that you have applied this product on. So keep that in mind, that it's not going to break down immediately sometimes. But applying when they're not around, sometimes that's useful. Avoiding pesticide drift or leakage, that could get on the bees themselves. It could get on the plants they visit. For example, weeds, if you have dandelions, if you're spraying your yard for dandelions, that could be habitat for bees. Maybe don't look at them as not a kind plant to have around. And then it could be nesting areas you're spraying on, or water sources. This is really important. We don't think about bees as needing water because they drink nectar, right? They will still visit water sources to drink, or sometimes if they make a mud nest, they use that water to make the nest, to make a little tube. So if you have water, I always like to use the example, tractor tire tracks, and water will pool up from irrigation. Bees visit that all the time, but you want to think about that as being bee habitat. And then, as I mentioned, realizing that systemic insecticides might travel to nectar and pollen sometimes months later. If there is any indicator that you might have of bee toxicity, you might see a large bee kill. Sometimes if you find a lot of bees with their tongue out, that's bee toxicity. Sometimes when it's just really, really hot and it's just too hot for them, they'll die that way as well. But if you see a lot of bees with their tongues out, call Park. They are where you need to report bee toxicity events. So this is just an image to show you all the different places that bees reside and where they could be exposed to pesticides. All the things that I mentioned, they could be sprayed directly through landing on different things, even if they're not feeding, such as leaves, in the pollen and nectar itself, and their nesting material if it's on the ground. You may not even realize there are nests there in water, even if they're ephemeral water sources. They might visit them while they're still present. One thing I like to mention about the water sources is you can provide water sources in the form of a deep container so it doesn't evaporate too quickly in the summer, full of marbles, because they like a landing base. They won't just land. Sometimes they'll land around the side of a bird bath, but then they can land all over it, and they'll visit that versus other areas in which the water might be polluted by pesticides. So the Oregon Bee Atlas sounds like we've already got some folks that are in the know there. But basically, as I mentioned, it's a group that you can go out and it's pretty fun. It's kind of like being a kid at Easter and you're hunting for things. You just go out, you look for bees, see what they're visiting, net them, bring them back. Sometimes it's trapping, and you or someone else can actually learn to identify these bees and then make a specimen collection like I have on that table for that area. And it makes it a lot easier for people IDing down the road to just look and go, okay, that matches. So this is just to show, this is an outdated map. We've got a lot more groups, but there are regional teams statewide, and there's a leader to each team. So if you're interested in that, the Oregon Bee Project has a page on the Oregon Bee Atlas, and you can sign up there. We're providing more and more trainings all the time, especially in forestry. And I encourage you to look at the Oregon Bee Project website. There's a lot of information there. It's really evolving, a lot more information to come. So visit it regularly. And that's it. So if you have any questions for me, we can go for it. And then I'll also hang around here a little bit if you want my card that I'm realizing I don't know if I have. But I'll give you my information and we can connect. Yes.
Okay, so we're particularly interested in honeybees. And we're interested in the feral colonies in the woods.
Yeah.
Do you find very many feral colonies?
Occasionally, yeah. It's always exciting because they're usually nesting in a tree trunk.
Right.
And it's somebody that's cutting it to harvest the tree, or because it's a hazard tree or whatever, they're removing it, they cut it, and they'll find a nest inside the trunk.
But but you don't actually, when you're, what they don't actually find them in a tree, living there and leave it there. I mean,
sometimes, yeah. There's actually a great example in Hillsborough that an arborist called me about. I think we have a bee tree here, and it's in an area that wouldn't be dangerous. Should I just leave it? And I was like, absolutely, and you can see it. It's still being used. So in certain areas, yeah, some people will just let it be.
The research has shown that a honeybee, a Tom Seeley out in Cornell, that that he would find bee trees about every half mile, that was the area that a bees okay. needed. So we were hoping that we could put a bait hive near a feral colony so that when they swarm, which they're going to do because the space is too small in the tree, that we could actually catch and entice that swarm to come.
Sure.
But it doesn't sound like there's any way we could find those through you.
No, we do not map those, so I don't have those listing locations. I would connect with, whenever there's a feral swarm, I always say go to Oregon, the Oregon Beekeeping Association, because somebody there is going to want
that. We have our own swarm catchers. It's just finding feral colonies.
I was going to say word of mouth. But I will say, relative to what you're talking about and attracting them to a hive, there is a woman, used to be my old boss, actually. She was a professor at OSU in entomology, and her name is Lynn Royce. So beehive trees?
Yes.
Beehive bees?
Yes.
Yeah. Getting those, so basically what it is, it's a nest box that it's on a pulley system. You put it up in a tree, and the hive box is altered a little bit to replicate the inside of a tree. So it's trying to promote bees utilizing the habitat that they used to. As I mentioned, honeybees used to nest in tree cavities, and so that could be a potential source for them to go back to that, but it would be in a hive, we could still utilize them rather than laying them in place to place. But that could be using a trap like that, they might more readily come to that. But no, I don't have a source of where all the bee trees are. I wish I did, that would be great. You might connect with ISA, International Society of Arborists, because I think they're the ones that get called first when bees are found in trees. They want the tree to be taken down. So,
when you were talking about mites, obviously honeybees have a serious problem with mites. Do native bees have a serious problem with mites too?
Anything that's living out in the wild is mites, and I mean...
The same varroa mites? The same ones that the honeybees
have? I don't know about varroa mites. I don't know about that, which mites they have. But I mean, anytime you collect any insects out in the wild, you look at them under a specimen, you're likely to see mites, and some of those can be damaging in wild bees. But it's really only intensively studied in agriculture where those bees are pollinating the crops that we have. So, but I don't know about varroa mites for that.
I'm going to let Kim ask one, then I have one more.
Oh, sure.
You're on a roll.
last year, for the first time in Tillamook, we had so many bumblebees that we could not believe how many bumblebees. We had 10 times as many as we've ever seen. And when I was at the county fair, even the people in Portland would say, can you believe all the honeybees this year? Do you know of any reason why last year would have been? Because they're supposed to be dying out, but we just had 10.
Are you talking about bumblebees or honeybees?
But we had bumblebees.
Okay.
Did I say honeybees? Sorry. Bumblebees.
Yeah. I don't know, but it's all, how many queens made it through the winter, So if you had a healthy queen colony the year before that made it, then you would definitely have more colonies in it, There could be a lot of different factors as to why that.
We had such a mild winter last year.
Yeah, we did have a really mild winter.
Did you have lots?
We had lots of bumblebees. I got a boomer for them, so they just swarm around you when you walk through the fields.
Yeah, so it depends on how many queens made it. If there's a good habitat for them, they all got fed well, then it goes well for them. That's a good thing to hear.
I was just going to ask whether any of the federal agencies are involved in bee habitat.
Yeah, so I think you came in a little late. So just to recap on that. So in 2015, there was a federal initiative to enhance pollinator habitat. That's all pollinators, not just bees. And basically, it was trying to get the states individually to come up with plans of like, how are we going to tackle this? And the EPA actually put forth some guidelines in terms of trying to, now there's better infrastructure for reporting bee toxicity. So anytime we think that bees might have been poisoned from pesticides, there's a number to call. Anytime, and trying to enhance the trainings for pesticide applicators. So now they're actually dedicated bee courses. So when you have your pesticide applicator license, you have to take classes every year to stay current with your license. And now they have a pollinator course that they have to be aware of, thinking about interactions with bees. And so the federal agencies are working on that. The Forest Service, we're connecting with them on some of these things. I mean, all of USDA, so agriculture and the Forest Service and NRCS, they are all tackling this as well. And we're all working together with the state agencies and the federal agencies on what are you doing, how can we work together, and we're all communicating about our progress, what we're finding, and tackling new things that we need to learn more about. So we've gotten some money from the state to actually do this work, which is nice, rather than just being asked to do something and not being given any money. It's hard to get work done, but when you're asked to do something and given money, that's when work gets done. Yeah.
And that talk from the gentleman from OSU.
Jim Rivers?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I've heard him talk 3 or 4 times this year at different meetings I've gone to.
Okay.
So he's really being aggressive about letting us know what the bee warnings on the labels mean.
Oh,
because some bee labels say, don't apply it when the bee is present, or don't apply it when they're active. And there's a difference in being present and being active.
Yeah.
Kind of a deal. There's all through these whole wording things, and is letting everybody know how to interpret that warning on the pesticide label.
And I think it might be Andoni you're talking about, the heads of the Oregon Bee Project that did that training. The Oregon Bee Project folks are doing a lot of training, and so you probably start to see the same faces at events here and there, because community engagement is really a huge piece of this. Yeah.
Tell me when I outdo my number of questions. I have two more. Last year we also had so many yellow jackets, and they must have a redeeming value, but I haven't found what it is yet. and I can never find the nest.
Yeah.
And they're horrible. They'll kill a hive of honeybees.
Sure.
Yeah, we have to close them down because they'll go in and kill them. So is there anything you could tell me about finding the nest or doing anything? What can you tell me specifically about yellow jackets?
Well, first I'll start off with last year when I was climbing up the hill doing ground checks. I got stung in the face 13 times by yellow jackets, and I still like them. So, I think they do have redeeming qualities in that they're carnivores and they're predators. And so they actually will go after a lot of things that are pests, and they're cleaning up things like roadkill. If we didn't have these insects cleaning up that roadkill, they'd just be piling up.
I thought the blackbirds and the crows and all that.
But bees too. So, and floss, I mean. So, last year was a really heavy yellow jacket year. Same reason with the bumblebees, that they just had a lot of queens that survived, that did really well due to mild winters and whatnot. There's also a non-native, and I guess you could call it invasive because it is very aggressive and seeping over areas, yellow jacket, the German yellow jacket, and that the population of that we think is increasing even in western states. So it could be both of those combinations, that our natives are just making it through the winter, and then we've got this invasive that it's blooming as well. But with yellow jackets, so it's a little confusing, but most yellow jackets are ground nesting. They have these big networks of combs underneath the ground. We also have an aerial yellow jacket that has a paper nest. Bald-faced hornet has a paper nest, not a hornet, it's a wasp, has a paper nest. Paper wasp, so you'll see some paper-based nests up aerially as well. What I'm guessing, though, you probably have more ground nesting. Those are really common. And there's not much you can do other than move the hive out of that area because there's something they like in that area. I will tell you, they do not reuse nests, ever. But doesn't mean they won't move next door and start a nest because they like this habitat. So that queen might come out and go, I'm going to go right next door and make another nest. If it's an aerial wasp, so it has the nest above ground, one thing that sometimes works, if you take a brown paper lunch bag and blow it up and then hang that near your hive, it looks to them like it's another nest, and they go, oh, I don't want to be in this territory, and so they won't build a nest or really venture forth. So that could work, but if it's a ground nesting wasp, they don't care about those. So, yeah, but that's a hard one.
Okay. We had a problem when we thought of the bald-faced hornet, where it's pink, like the size of your thumb, and white.
Yeah.
Here?
Yeah.
That's a bald-faced hornet?
Bald-faced, it looks more like black and white. It's actually yellow, but it looks more black and white, yeah.
Huge.
Yeah, they can get really big.
Okay, are there different varieties? Because there's, in my eye, a book that's not that black, pure black with the white.
Okay. Well, there are a lot of different types of wasps, and the bald-faced is one specific species. There might be other wasps that maybe that's one that you found, but the bald-faced is typically that big one with the white.
I mean, we're talking the size of your thumb.
That's really big. So there is, and it was white, was it yellow? Because there's a European hornet, but that's not found here in the western states. That's really big and not aggressive. But you didn't catch it, did you?
No, they come right into the hive. They come right to the landing board and just right in and eat. I mean, they're super aggressive.
I mean, I'm not telling you to catch it, but if you were to catch it, I'd take a look at it.
Okay,
I'd like to see what it is. Or a picture.
Okay.
I mean, even a picture.
Nail it with a pin and stick it there. And,
okay. I mean,
because they're not really fast, like the yellow jacket.
Yeah, they are aggressive, though. So that's what I'm saying. Like, that's at your own risk. Don't say that Christine's was aggressive. But at night, they're less active. There are still guards that will look. If you flash a flashlight at night, you can still see some are, like, looking. But are they nesting in the ground?
We don't know where they're nesting.
Okay.
Because
their ball skates are above ground.
I mean, just
okay.
Down.
But if you go in at night, they're less active, and if you put a red film over your flashlight, they can't see that light. So you could come in and, like, look at them and, you know, bag a couple.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can I do one more? I know we
sure.
Right. If a person wanted to, and there's a lot that do, want to take unused land and turn it into a pollinator habitat, the first problem you come to, there are several problems, so the first problem you come to is there's grass on it already, there's, you know, it's covered with stuff. And that outdoes, if that was healthy weeds, that'd be great. We wouldn't even do anything about it. But assuming it's like grass, if you were to use in the early spring an herbicide to kill that grass,
yeah.
How long, I mean, and there's no bees flying or anything like that, is that a bad thing because the herbicide?
It depends on what you're using. So it's not just insecticides that can harm bees.
Right.
There's a little bit of evidence that even fungicides and herbicides, some of them have some, sometimes it's a secondary ingredient, something that's inactive,
right.
Like a sticker that can have an impact. I would like to send you to the Oregon Department of Agriculture with that question. I have a contact that I think could better give you a list of
okay.
products that he would suggest rather than,
thank you.
Yeah, yeah. And he's actually on the Oregon Bee Project Steering Committee, so he's
okay.
up on his bees and his pesticides, and I think that he would be the best source.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Can I jump in here? All right. So I'm just taking a look at the time, just making sure that we're at an hour here. You are welcome to stick around and have some more coffee. We have plenty over here. Also, if you have some time to answer
yeah,
other questions too,
around.
Seems like we have a very interesting group, so thank you for coming up today. I just want to, for those of you who might want to kind of carry on, I just want to say thank you for coming today. We really appreciate you coming. Thank you for Christine for coming up today.
Thank you.
Like this, consider coming and checking out some of the other fresh fruit forestry presentations that we have coming up. The next one's going to be on April 20th. We have Marcus Kaufman. He is our biomass specialist in the department. So he kind of talks about, he does all sorts of really interesting projects on what to do with wood waste and how we're getting energy and other things from things like that. So that's the next one coming up in April. And we also do a lot of other interpretive programs, so keep an eye out on their website. And if you like things like this, consider making a donation or checking out the gift shop up front where all the proceeds go back to the center here. So other than that, I'll just say if you have any coffee cups and things like that that are empty, you can just leave them in the sink here. We'll clean them up, but just feel free to stick around, make yourself comfortable. Hope you have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Christine, was there a name?
Oh, yeah.